upon this at one point, but I'm just kind of curious for everybody. When you were originally approached, was it a matter of being enthusiastic, or was there a thought of, oh God, are we talking about this again? I mean, is this a story that you've been asked, you know, countless times over the last 25 years?
Well, I think we've all been asked a bazillion times. What's Madonna like?
Oh, okay.
You know, like, I think we were all sort of inundated with those, like, requests our entire careers, and I think, for myself personally, I kind of kept quiet about that stuff for ages, mostly because of the lawsuit, and didn't bring it up, and I realized that when I met them, this would be a wonderful opportunity to really share that time, and own it again, and remember it with fondness, and rediscover it, and rediscover these boys. And I think Luis has more to say on this. So I was a big yes, so I'm like, yeah, let's do it!
Yeah, he was a yes right away. I was no. And so, you know, I kind of ignored their first request. Anyway, but
and my call.
Yeah. And then, you know, Kevin called. You know, started calling, and you know, my partner was like, "You should really call Kevin back." And so I called Kevin back, and Kevin was like, "No, you should really, you know, do this. They're legit." So that's, you know, after a while, I said yes.
They had a different point of view. I think that was originally what got us all on board, is that they're Dutch filmmakers, and they're the way they look at things is a very humanist sort of approach, and they're not concerned with sensationalism like LA and New York. I think America would have been all about this resolution and sensationalism and ideas of gossip and all this stuff, and I think their point of view was just about love and what this experience really was. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Carlton, your thoughts?
I was an easy yes. You know, we got hit up in around August of 2013. They found us on Facebook, believe it or not. And, you know, it was just the initial email. They were really thorough in making sure that we were aware that, you know, they really wanted to do something that honored our story and our voice. And they were very specific about that. And as Kevin was saying, you know, I think that was sort of the pin in it that was different than most. You know, over the years, getting, again, all the various kinds of invitations to do things to speak about it. This was, you know, the first time that somebody said, "You guys matter." You know, and so, yeah.
And two for you as Gabriel's representation, I guess, in the story. You obviously have mixed feelings about, you know, Truth or Dare and various aspects of the tour, but was it important for you to participate?
You know, I wasn't exactly the demographic for Truth or Dare. And if my son wasn't, you know, hadn't been in it, and I loved the dancing, I thought it was kind of boring, actually. And I could say, really? Are you sure that people really want to hear about this? You know, what happened to these guys? And there's a, and you know, Ryer, they both said, you know, this is a cult film. I sort of knew that. But I really didn't get it. And that's a little bit obvious in the film. I mean, I didn't really get it about Truth or Dare till we went to New York to Tribeca, and I saw myself in this way I hadn't really ever gotten it about the impact it had. So, and just to put it here out, I've said this all along, that I and all of Gabriel's family and friends, we know positively that if he had lived, he would, like all of us, be incredibly proud of what happened with Truth or Dare. And I mean, in spite of all the grief it cost him in different ways, and the kiss and all of that, it would be by now a great irony of his life that this kiss that was so, you know, miserable and made him, his boyfriend, so angry and all these things, that it was a wonderful thing. And it's quite a, in the end, it's quite a great legacy, actually. Kiss. Yeah. Yeah. We're all proud have this happen, you know, 20 years after his death, is, you can imagine, quite miraculous.
I think it calls up how much the world has changed in a quarter century, you know, because I remember that tour. I saw that tour. That was when, you know, Madonna was on the cover of The Advocate, and it was just such a huge deal. And you guys were really kind of just at the epicenter of this really exciting gay moment where, yeah, I mean, we had been dealing with AIDS, and there was, you know, we hadn't even gotten to the awful sort of 92 Republican convention yet, but just your existence in the world made a difference, and it was this thing to look at. It was this hot sort of focal point. And it's amazing. I think, obviously, you guys all sort of tell a story in the film that you really, you know, gone through the last 25 years and suffered through things and come out of it. And I'm wondering, was there anything in the movie itself in telling your story on camera that was therapeutic, or are we just seeing the reflection of your own journey to get to before this movie had started, that you were already there and now you're just telling us about it?
I mean, I'll speak to that. I mean, you know, it's an awesome time right now for myself, you know, in that one, you know, Slam is not here right now, but I'm so grateful that I'm fully on the other side of it emotionally, you know, that I get to be a bit of strength for him, and he's reached out to me with questions about the process and the journey, and that's incredible. And, you know, like Sue was just speaking in regards to irony, you know, it is something to realize, y'all know, everybody knows, you've gone through a thing, and to realize for myself that, you know, that thing that I thought for sure 100% would marginalize my life, you know, the HIV information, that beast, that, you know, God and the universe and the angels and my prayers and my tears could happen in a way that I would then, we would all then be edified, whether it's drugs or whether it's court or whatever, you know, you so don't know what this journey is supposed to be about. And so that's just, it's just amazing. And it's such a gift right now that we get to be celebrated for the truth as the fucking truth. Yeah. Just these moments are therapeutic. I mean, I've been jumping around, I think, more than all these guys, like, just because I know what value there is in being here, this affirmation, the acknowledgement, the appreciation of the film and their stories, and observation of oneself on the camera. And I really realized that this gives me the opportunity to look back at my life and all those 25 years of moments of telling myself that you didn't do anything that moved anybody, that you didn't do anything that was worthwhile, that you don't matter, that you don't have skill, that whatever you're doing for some random pop star or some ephemeral something, it doesn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. All those things I told myself that I didn't matter. That
you do.
In the distance, in the dark, whatever, that it was reaching people, that it did have impact. And just experiencing these moments with everybody else, sharing themselves with us, I mean, that's the best therapy ever. And I get to listen to myself and go, you know what? You were telling yourself a big fucking story that whole time, and shut up. And start telling yourself a new fucking story.
You guys all seem to be teaching, which I think is great. I mean, you've got these extraordinary skills, and now you're sort of sharing them. And I'm wondering for, you know, teenagers today, like, do they even relate to this tour, to this era of Madonna? I mean, like, she's sort of this Pleistocene of her own, where there's these separate compartments and eras of her. Does early 90s Madonna just seem prehistoric to them?
I hope not. The funny story is when I first started dating my partner, he, you know, we got into this, you know, tit for tat, and he said basically, you know, well, nobody knows who you are anymore, honey, so relax. Anyway, make a long story short, we went around the corner to the, you know, to the yogurt stop, and the 18-year-old behind the fucking counter freaked the fuck out.
That was good. Okay.
And so I turned to David, I was like, honey, will you take a picture of that? I hope that's good.
Carlton, you were in one of my favorite nuclear cinema movies, Grief, and incredibly sexy in that movie, and such a great romantic lead. And I would have loved to see you act more, and now I can see from this film that that was a period for you where you felt like you were acting all the time. That your very presence in public was a performance in a way. Mm.
Yeah. I mean, you know, exactly as I said, I don't know, man. You know, it is. Thank God I'm a performer. You know, I think being a performer saved my life. You know, I was never one of those gay guys that got diagnosed that married myself to the litany of information about HIV. You know, so there was a level of denial, so to speak, you know, acting as if I was something else that I needed to do for that phase of my life and those chapters.
I think it's hard to even explain to somebody what a 1985 HIV diagnosis even mm-hmm. meant.
That's true.
I mean, there was no medication. There was sketchy information at best. And that you could survive that period and so physically thrive at a time when, as you guys point out in the film, people were just dropping right and left. And it's extraordinary that there were three people on that stage in that era of the epidemic where the medicine was not there and the healthcare was not there, you know, busting your asses like that on a nightly basis and being in such prime physical form, and that's you're mutants.
I don't think people really realize the environment that this tour happened in. You know, it was just not talked about. That's why when people see, if you're younger, I don't know, but if you saw this in now and you see the kiss, you're kissing, no big deal. But back then, it really was a huge issue. Nobody had seen that at all on screen. And so the issue come up, like, what if they had come out as HIV positive during the tour? And it would have been too big for her to handle, I think. The issue is, carry the banner, but then when it actually comes down to responsibility and liability on stage, you'd be like, I love you, and you're fired.
Yeah, that was the Rock Hudson, you know, Dynasty Kiss era, which is a whole...
Yeah, and for me, I mean, I didn't come out to my family about my status for 14 years, you know? I was diagnosed in 85, and I think it was around, I don't know, it's 14 years later. You know, so, you know, if I don't have enough self-confidence, sense of self to trust that my mom and my dad and my brother or sister will still love me, I ain't tripping about a woman on stage. You know, I mean, seriously, like, that's the least of my concerns. You know, though it was obviously a big concern, and you know, I said it in regards to what happened in Japan, but you know, I think, you know, again, I think what has helped me and saved me, and I don't think my doctor is here. He was invited. I saw him earlier, Philip. He's been with me for a long time, but you know, I think for all of us, you know, we've got a legacy of shoulders that we get to stand on. You know, and I know for myself, you know. I came from the south side of Chicago with parents that were, you know, fighting and all kinds of crazy stuff going on, and I had to remember what I was made of. You know, the bigger stock of what I was, you know. I was a street dude, you know. And so whenever I got sort of extra scared about what my body was saying or what numbers were saying, you know, I had to lean into my ancestry and all those folks that made it through some shit that was crazier than mine. So, and also just the spiritual journey for me. You know, I think that, you know, I'm so grateful that I got called to be aware of who I was aside from skin and bones, you know, and that I get to lean into that. So it's been a mixed bag of tricks that I use. You know, if you got a chance to have a camera inside my house, I'm doing some interesting shit. But I'm here, and I'm here good and well, so there you go. And Niki and Donna are here. Can Niki and Donna stand up? I was in New York, I was working on a play, and some stuff went down here in LA, and it had, you know, it had gotten out at a club, I found out. She called me, hey, call me, I have a bone to pick with you, is what she said, you know, and when I called her back, she said, I was at this party, and so was, you know, sharing this about you, you know, why didn't you tell me, didn't you know that I would never not love you through that, you know, and Niki Harris had been such my...
I love you for that.
So, anyway.
These lovely people would love to answer some questions.
Yeah.
I'm sure some of you have. Yes, sir, right here.
Well, I have a question for Kevin and Luis. I'm from Brazil, and I remember specifically watching Blond Ambition VHS like 300 times a day. And when you perform Cherish, dressing as sirens, and me and my gay friends, we watched that. We were still close at that, and we were watching that, and we're like, oh my God, how can they be so gay? And like, we felt like we could be so gay as well. How was like for, you know, at the time, today being flamboyant sometimes is not well seen among gay people. And how do you think you inspired like the gay guys who were more effeminate to like feel free to be who they were?
I don't know if I've always been aware of my flamboyance. Everyone else was more aware of my flamboyance.
We were aware.
Oh my God. You were aware. I was.
I mean, I don't know. I was. I love being a merman, so you know.
It was fucking fun.
It was fun, and you know, honestly, at that moment when we were doing all that stuff, we didn't think as far as what we were doing on the stage.
It didn't feel
gay. With Madonna, you know, we were so. Well, I felt that.
That's so cheesy. And,
I mean, mermaid skirt, you all track. But honestly, we really wasn't thinking beyond what we were doing at the time. I mean, and that's the gift of what has come from all that, that we did reach out to people and say something, and mean something, you know? And that has been the gift of this whole journey, to be present for that now is, you know, is a gift.
And a big thanks to Alec Ashishian as well, whose message this is just as much as Madonna's. It really is. It's
the camera. Yes.
Thank you. If you gentlemen never met Madonna, if you never went on tour and never had this opportunity, what would your legacy be like? Would it be the same? What would you have done with yourself?
Well, I don't think I would have been a dancer. I sort of fell into it. I ran out of money and I auditioned for Julie McDonald, my agent right here in the front.
My first agent,
and I auditioned for her and got an audition the next day, got a job the next day. So suddenly I was working and I was a dancer, and within just a couple months I was on tour as associate choreographer and a dancer. It was not in my plans at all. I don't think I would be dancing at all. But I'm so glad I have, because it is who I am, and once a dancer, always a dancer.
You know, they were doing the whole like House of Extravaganza thing in New York. So, you know, we were traveling in that, you know, we were already had gone to Japan and doing the anything. And so I think that would have just continued for us, you know, being in that house. I mean, Jose is now the father of the house today. So I still travel, you know, in that aspect. So I think, you know, that would have continued for both of us. And I can't believe that Julie Donald is here. That's so amazing. I remember walking into my first agency and then, you know, she came from the back like, that was my job. I was like, oh, shit. I don't know.
I'm like, oh. Yeah, on the island.
It's a couple of part question, and I don't know how much any you can answer, but there's a lot of Madonna music footage, everything in there, and I'm curious if you guys know how the filmmakers were able to get all that permission, and can you talk about where the lawsuits ended up, and do you know if she's
That's a lot of questions.
Well, a lot of the footage was used through fair usage, is what's called fair usage. So they can use up to a certain amount.
Like press and televised stuff. But they also bought, they purchased footage from Miramax, because Miramax actually owns it, not Madonna, but they had to get her permission and she did sign off. So that was very expensive paid for material that they bought. Second part, lawsuit. Yes, we won the lawsuit. It was really simple clause in our contract. For a feature film, this is what you get paid. Like, it was so simple. Like, it didn't, I don't under, it was really unfortunate that the press went and ran with it and tried to discount every wonderful thing about Truth or Dare that came out. The idea that we were family, the idea that the love that we had, which is all true, and everything that was on that in that film was exactly what we were doing. That was just us on tour. And they took the opportunity to kind of twist words and misinform everybody and try to make it into a big sensationalist pile of crap. But we won, and I'm proud that we took that action, because, you know, if anything I learned from her was to stand up for myself and be strong, and even if that was to her. And it was the it had the most integrity of any choice that I could have made at the time. And it's allowed me to be a voice for our community and the dance community ever since.
And to your other question in regards to her response, or if we've gotten feedback, we've not heard from her as of yet, but her publicist did give us a reach out when we were actually at Tribeca. She saw an industry screener of it and responded that she absolutely, absolutely loved it for a multitude of reasons, and that she would pass it on to him.
So if anyone hears anything, let us know.
All the way in the back.
Yes.
Hey there, I love the movie. I love this tour, and probably like a lot of people there, I remember every number. It's still the tour that all of the tours we compare to. I would love to hear, what was your favorite part of the show to do every night? And if anything ever went wrong.
All of the Like a Prayer stuff was my favorite, you know, getting to do, you know, throw her around and
butt her off.
Well, I think everybody knows my favorite. I really loved coming up on that hydraulic lift with a big feather boa.
My favorite was Keep It Together.
Yeah.
Well, because we all got to interact with each other. It's like, we knew we were there, we knew the show was over, we didn't have to like hold any energy back. We got to actually like say hello, say goodbye, peace out. As far as things going wrong, in Papa Don't Preach, I think it was Chicago or something, she comes to team up behind me, and we look away, I don't know if you remember the number. I'm looking away, and I go that way. Well, she comes up to sing near me, and she was in the wrong spot. When I turned to go that way, over across the stage, she had her mic right here, and it smashed into her mouth and broke her tooth in half on stage, in the middle of the concert.
That's why you had a lawsuit. That was her lawsuit.
Yes. Yeah. I was like, oh my god. Looking at her back with, you know, she had the, you know, look of doom on her face. Burst into flames at any moment. Yeah.
Over there.
Realize
this.
Yeah, I mean, like, you know, Kevin and I were talking about this at one of the other screeners. You know, it's you know, it's an odd reality, you know, because again, we have all been getting communication from fans and people every single year throughout the years. And, you know, not that we rest everything in the media stuff, but there's something about, you know, People Magazine and Rolling Stone and Pulse and all these things that are speaking about us in these ways that, you know, we realized that we didn't really take seriously coming from the people all these years. And it's the ramp up of this that's been happening, and, you know, the ongoing celebration, and that it's happening now. I mean, it really is happening now.
It's been easy to discount, you know, various Madonna fans over the years, little emails, oh my god, I'm a huge Madonna fan, I love you, oh, you changed my life. It's easier to discount that, where you're like, oh, it's about Madonna. But when it's response to this, which really is, she's a concert, so it's really about our story, then really now it's landing, finally.
I just am always struck every time I see it, that it's just such a beautiful film, and so beautifully edited, and I'm seeing all kinds of things, but it's been fascinating because, and it's like, not only didn't I get it, what this film meant, but in a way they keep disclosing how they really didn't get it, and that it just keeps unfolding how important it was, and and also, they're so interesting now. I mean, even if they made this film when these guys were 35, like 10, years ago or more, they're just so interesting because they've been through so much, and the film holds a lot of wisdom about what it's like to have that experience at 20, and then what do you do after that? If that's your career, how do you possibly follow that act? And they've had all these years to do whatever, it's, you know, whatever's gonna happen, but at 45, they're just on that other side, the wisdom side of it. And it's just a beautiful thing to watch. And by the way, Salim asked me to send his love to everybody here.
So following up with that, do you think the filmmakers thought this was just a Where Are They Now story, or did they know something?
They're very deep, these two. You can tell by the quality of the interviews that they elicited. And I mean, I heard Luis say at a Q&A, because I watched much too many of them because they're all traveling around, how he didn't think he wanted, I mean, at this age, to have to rehash something that happened in 1990, like, no, that's not a good thing for him, you know, personally, to just keep doing it. And I remember being so, well, I mean, like, enough already, and I've got to have something else to talk about here. And it was so moving, and I think, but they just asked beautiful questions and just got it. So they went around to each of us, then longer, for weeks, maybe a meeting, 3 days, until I thought, these people are really interesting and really, you know, because I had no time at all for all the rest of it. It wasn't, you know, for me it was like, okay, Bill did this wonderful thing, but it wasn't supposed to be I was a snob, it wasn't supposed to be the pinnacle of his career. He was going to do all these other things. And really, we gave up, all the rancor was gone 20 years ago, and there was nothing more to say about it, really, except that it seemed like there were all these people that had seen this film so many times, and it was so meaningful. So it's been like a revelation, and they are just wonderful people, and they just got the best out of everybody, I think.
And I was looking at the point about the impact you guys had. I mean, there was not really much as far as mainstream gay culture at that point. So to have this troupe of beautiful, talented, outspoken, uninhibited, unafraid, honest gay men in a movie was earth-shattering. And I can't even imagine, and I'm your age, if I were a teenager seeing that movie in high school and being able to see it under the umbrella of, well, Madonna movie, of course everybody loves Madonna, but it would have blown my mind.
I think also that it was diverse. It was so important. You know, all the different ethnicities, you didn't see that. It was a very blonde, buff, and white.
You can barely see it now.
You can barely see it now. So this was a revelation of diversity.
We have time for a couple more.
Right.
Yes, right. There.
Yeah, I have a question for Carlton. What was your experience like working on the Gorilla Show?
Oh, the Gorilla Show.
My first Madonna show.
What was that?
My first Madonna show.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Awesome. The Gorilla Show, I mean, look, you know, clearly it is fact that that the Blond Ambition stent is my favorite because of everything that's going on. But my favorite to perform was the Gorilla Show, hands down.
Fever.
I love that number.
Yeah.
I love a lot of that number. I mean, of that tour, you know. For me, person, like the whole fucking mermaid shit, So it was, you know, for me, it was, you know, it was more elegant. It was a mature show. You know, it felt very grown up, and that worked for me. So that was my favorite. Mm.
Yeah.
yeah.
What's the next step for the movie? Is there a plan for a wider release or online streaming? Or I'm hoping. Come on.
I guess we can. Well, there are deals in place, and there's a lot of deals in the works. So I can't say specifically about what plan is, although we're hoping that we have a full wide theatrical release.
Yay!
In Holland and in Belgium already.
It started in Europe, and the fact that I do know that there's some very exciting things happening.
Yeah.
We'll do one more, and we'll wrap this up. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you guys could talk about your upcoming projects or what's next for each of you.
I sing as That Rogue Romeo, which is like my music I do.
It's amazing. Real talk.
I'm having a TV show this fall, which I can't talk about yet.
Super
And I'm working on a documentary that I shot with my dad, who is right here. Hi, Daddy.
Hey.
We've been trying to get together.